thanking to Lieutenant Governor Kim Reynolds and the state of Iowa for hosting us here today. I have to say what an honor it is to be with Sir Faisal Hassan Abed, the founder of Brock, and someone I've long admired. And now it is equally an honor to be here with Miss Jeannie Borlaug Laube, Dr. Borlaug's daughter. I know that events like this often are the work of sort of Sherping all year round. So I heard earlier from him that there are only 11 people full-time on the World Food Prize staff. So that just must have been an Herculean effort to organize this. So I want to thank all of you for having us. And I had the opportunity for coming here this afternoon to meet with some of the extraordinary Borlaug Milan intern alums. And I was so tremendously impressed and left even more optimistic than I arrived earlier this morning. I'm so grateful that I was asked to talk about the role of empowering and franchising, including women and girls, in solving our food security challenges. As I know many of you are aware, we have a crisis at the moment that will only amplify as we have more and more people. We currently have at least 800 million people who are not getting the nutritious food that they need, and we certainly are not on track at the moment to be able to feed the 9 million people we expect to have on Earth by 2050. And we fundamentally believe in the Clinton Foundation, and I imagine there are many here who agree, that ensuring that women have the same access, the same opportunities, the same inputs, the same capital that men do around the world is a crucial, vital, and necessary part of solving that challenge. And as Vice Chair of the Clinton Foundation, I'm proud that we're part of trying to do that work on the ground in Malawi, Rwanda, and Tanzania, as you heard Ken mention in his introduction. We work in partnership with governments, and I'm so thrilled that you're having former President Joyce Banda, who is one of my heroines, someone who was part of starting our work with the Clinton Development Initiative in Malawi a few years ago. Because we believe that NGOs like the Clinton Foundation are really there to help fill the gap between what the public sector currently provides as a public good and what the private sector has a sufficiently robust business case to produce. And we believe we always need to have an exit strategy whenever we enter into partnership with governments and businesses. And so what we do through the Clinton Development Initiative is to aggregate together groups of smallholder farmers to help them have access to better quality seed, better quality fertilizer, technical training so that they understand how best to use the fertilizer and the seed, access to climate-smart agriculture possibilities like crop rotation and mulching and agroforestry. And we're deeply committed to ensuring that women are part of everything we do. And there was amazing music that just went off. But I think yes, thank you. That the cell phone companies, and hopefully all of us agree, in our programs, we have thresholds of at least 40% participation by women smallholder farmers. And I am thrilled that we have exceeded that in every country in which we work and every community in which we work. That means that we're above what we think is the average in sub-Saharan Africa, which is 43% in terms of women smallholder participation. We don't know that with a sufficiently robust understanding because of all the data gaps that we face in mapping out the challenges but also the opportunities in agriculture, something I hope that we can talk more about during the subsequent panel. As we say in my family, investing and empowering girls and women isn't just the right thing to do, it's a smart thing to do. Ken mentioned my mother's program, Feed the Future, through work that was sponsored by the U.S. State Department. We know that if smallholder female farmers in sub-Saharan Africa had access to the same quality seed and fertilizer, but equally important access, the same levels of capital at the same interest rates as their male colleagues did, sub-Saharan Africa could feed itself. That is in all of our interests. We're trying to do our part to help solve that challenge. We also think it's equally important that women farmers stars aren't only participants, but also leaders through the Clinton Development Initiative, but also more broadly. Our lead farmers, in cooperation with field officers and government extension workers, are at the heart of our agronomic training. They act as peer mentors to new farmers who join the training. They host and own and maintain active demonstration plots so that farmers can visit their plots to see if they're interested in joining our program. They're really the leaders in helping to educate others on the Climate Smart Agriculture policies. And I'm proud that although we have a threshold of 30% of our lead farmers being women, again, that's something that we've exceeded in every country and every community in which we work. And so what does that mean in the areas where we work? What does it mean to have really empowered female farmers? Well, I'd like to share a couple of stories that we certainly have front and center as why we continue to work so hard in this area. Wazia Chwala is from Tanzania. She's a single mother. She's younger than I am, 35. She has 7 children. She relies on her crops to both feed her family and generate income. Since joining our program, she has become the demonstration plot owner and one of the project's most successful lead farmers ever. She's increased her yields by 1,000%, and she's Yaba, and she's earned enough money to buy a cow and to send all 7 of her children to school, including her girls. She's also become an active advocate for why it's so important for female farmers to step up to be leaders, and why it's so important that female and male farmers send their boys and girls to school. She's also a role model in changing perceptions in her community about women, about what women can do and can become. To me, that's pretty remarkable. She's not only changing her family's future, she's changing her community's future. We've also been privileged to work with Lucy Banda in Malawi, now related to President Banda. She joined our program in 2012 after she walked through a friend's field and noticed that her friend's field was more productive in both the corn and soya crops that she was growing. By working with her field officer and learning new techniques to improve the quality of her soil, Lucy's been able to increase her yearly income from $50 to $750 in just 2 years. She decided that she believed so strongly in this that she became a secretary of her local club, and that she also was going to help other women take leadership positions, taking responsibility not only for her own advancement, but for her cohort's advancement as well. She's used her additional income to, yes, also send her children to school, to build a new home, to add solar panels to her home so that her children can do their homework at night. She bought an ox cart and 2 ox to pull it. And as she increases her soya production further, she plans to finish her house by pouring a concrete floor and buying a vehicle so that she can better get her product to market and help ensure that her family and her community can get to the hospital when they need more advanced health care than is available in their local clinic. She, too, is demonstrating leadership, not only for the women in her community, but also for the men. And I think those are the types of solutions that we need more of. Combating hunger, but also empowering women and girls, so that we're not only solving the challenge for today, but hoping to prevent that challenge from becoming more pernicious in the future. This is work we believe in so strongly at the foundation that it permeates other parts of our platform. Kim mentioned the Clinton Global Initiative. This year at the CGI meeting, I was proud to announce a new commitment by Hershey in partnership with the Ghana School Feeding Program. Hershey is going to provide an additional 7,500 smallholder farmers with specialized training in the production of groundnuts or peanuts, with an emphasis on engaging as many female farmers as possible. They've also committed to, at their own cost, constructing and maintaining a roasting facility until they can train the farmers in the roasting technologies, and the farmers can then not only do the roasting, but also themselves own the roasting facility, capturing more of the ultimate economics for themselves. Those nuts to buy, to use in the creation of Yeebi, a vitamin and mineral fortified protein snack that it produces locally in Ghana for use in the Ghana School Feeding Program. To me, that's pretty remarkable because it's empowering the Ghanaian farmers by helping them own more of their own economics, not only again for today, but in a sustainable way for the future, because the Ghana School Feeding Program has committed to buying feeding for at least a decade to come. And yet we know that we have more work to do in this country as well. And I don't think that we should have a moral equivalency about the various challenges that we face around the world, but I think we have to have a humility and an urgency about our own domestic food insecurity. I think it's unconscionable that in the wealthiest country on earth, 14% of Americans are food insecure. One out of five children is food insecure, and one out of three African-American children is food insecure. That is unacceptable, particularly because in this country, due to remarkable work that so many of the companies and organizations represented in this room today, we produce more than enough food to feed ourselves. We're working on this challenge in a couple of ways. You heard Ken mention our program through the Alliance for Healthier Generation, which is a partnership between the Clinton Foundation and the American Heart Association to help ensure that our children in American public schools get healthy, nutritious food and enough of it. So we work with schools so that they are more effectively using whatever their budgets may be to buy lunches that are healthy. We work with out-of-school programs like the Boys and Girls Club so that they're buying snacks that are healthy and nutritious and also have sufficient calories and the right calories for kids. And similarly, we're working to build a whole ecosystem so that it's not only when kids are in or out of school during the school year, but also during the summer and on weekends. And we believe strongly in this work because we can't solve childhood obesity without also tackling the child nutrition challenges in this country. Through the Clinton Global Initiative last year, we also launched a call to action on this specific question. What can we do about food security here in the United States? And this year, we learned some of the most interesting commitments to come out of that galvanizing effort. Admittedly, my favorite, and one I want to share with you this afternoon, is called the Food Security Genome Project. It brings together a pretty remarkable array of anti-hunger and technology leaders, including Mission Measurement, the Safeway Foundation, General Mills, Tyson Foods, Heifer International, and Share around a pretty simple, albeit quite challenging, mission to aggregate and code in an easily accessible, entirely publicly available platform every single study and program ever done by the federal government, a state government, a local government, a company or an NGO targeting hunger in the United States, ever. The effort's being led on their own time by the Pandora engineers, the people who built the Pandora music platform, on the belief that if we have a holistic data set, a truly holistic data set of what has worked and what hasn't worked, we'll have better predictive analytics about the cost and possible impact of new hunger and food security efforts in the future, so that hopefully we can all make decisions more quickly about where to invest our research dollars or our programmatic dollars, and if those dollars will be more effectively and efficiently put to use. This effort is just beginning. I hope to have it completed in the next 18 months, and I hope that all of you will use it. And what that says to me is that we all need to reach out more to unlikely partners. We all need to understand what we don't know and what could better inform our work. And certainly that's what we try to do at the Clinton Foundation by taking an ecosystem approach. Why I'm so thrilled that we're talking about girls and women today. I was with the Warlock Run scholars that I mentioned earlier, and a young man from Arkansas, so literally my favorite person to ask a question, asked me, what do you think some of the major barriers are to female farming participation around the world? And I said, well, some of them are probably female common participation around the world is child marriage. Now, in Malawi, until January, it was legal for a girl under the age of 18 to get married. So what that has meant is that historically, more girls under the age of 18 have gotten married than have gone to secondary school or gone to work in their family businesses, often family farms. So I think if we continue to think about what the barriers are to ensuring that we're really solving food security challenges together, but also really what the opportunities are to find unlikely partners like the Pandora Cruising Engineers to help us solve those challenges, I have no doubt that we'll get to the future that we want to see for all of our children.